shaped and has functions like an eye, and it's 1,500 light years across. And it's just something that we've only picked up on the last few years due to the powerful telescopes like the Hubble telescope and the telescope that's in Hawaii. But unfortunately, maybe if you guys want to see it later, I can show it to you after church. But let's dig into Jeremiah chapter 18. And no, Jeremiah was not a bullfrog, and he wasn't a good friend of mine, but he's in the Bible. Jeremiah chapter 18, verse 1. For some of the young kids in here, they're going, all right, Pastor Chris has lost his marbles. What is he talking about? It's a song, guys. That's what it is. It's a song. Jeremiah chapter 18, verse 1. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, arise and go down to the potter's house, and there I will let you hear my words. So I went down to the potter's house, and there he was working at his wheel. And the vessel he had been making of clay was spoiled in the potter's hand, and he had reworked it into another vessel, as seemed good to the potter to do. Then the word of the Lord came to me, O house of Israel, can I not do with you as the potter has done? Declares the Lord. Behold, the clay in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. If at any time I declare concerning a nation or kingdom that I will pluck it up and break it down and destroy it, and if that nation concerning which I have spoken turns from its evil, I will relent of the disaster I had intended to do to it. And if at any time I declare concerning a nation or kingdom that I will build and plant on it, and if it does evil in my sight, not listening to my voice, then I will relent of the good that I had intended to do to it. Now, therefore, say to the men of Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, thus says the Lord, behold, I am shaping disaster against you and devising a plan against you. Return everyone from his evil way and amend your ways and your deeds. May God bless the reading of his word as we dig into Jeremiah chapter 18, as we continue to look at the character and the nature and the attributes of God and his will. His will here being displayed for the nations and his abilities to rise up nations and to destroy nations according to his plan and his purposes. Go back to Jeremiah chapter 18, verse 1. This is the word of the Lord to Jeremiah. Jeremiah was used to, by this point, hearing from the Lord and bringing messages from the Lord, like in Jonah the VeggieTale movie. You know, do not fight, do not cheat. Wash your hands before you eat. I can't help, you know, being a parent of young ones and watching so many VeggieTales, I think I have all of the songs memorized at this point. But it's certainly true that the messages that the prophets brought were of different importances to the nation. Some of it was about keeping up the law and keeping themselves healthy. But other times, it was like the message Jeremiah here is bringing to them, a message of repentance and understanding God's working in their lives. In verse 2, he says, get up and go down to the potter's house. And I'm sure Jeremiah's sitting there like, okay, Lord, what's the plan this time? You know, am I going hellfire and brimstone? Are they going to repent? Or are they going to be stubborn and then we're going to go into exile? You know, what's the plan, God? No, Jeremiah, it's not the normal. Instead, I want you to go to a potter's house. And I'm sure Jeremiah's like, why do I want to go down to such a common place like a potter's house? It's not something that we're used to in our modern day. You know, pottery is somewhat of a hobby now, not a necessity for everyday living. And yet, in approximately 1,000 to 1,500 BC, it was very common within a town to have multiple potters that either specialized or did many different types of pottery for the needs for everyday. And so Jeremiah is probably going, all right, Lord, why do I need to go down basically to the grocery store to go check out what's going on in the potter's house? What's so special about this? And so God says in verse 2, I will let you hear my words. So So here Jeremiah is probably going, you know what, Lord, I hear from you all the time already. Why is it that you're going to clue me in on what's going on at the potter's house? Why is this special? But Jeremiah listens, and he goes down to the potter's house. And the potter was, in verse 3, working at his wheel. Now, I don't know if that's ever happened at this church, but I've been at several different churches where they'll have a potter come in, and they'll set up a large tarp, because pottery gets everywhere. And the water and the dirt just seem to go all over the place. And they'll talk about this particular passage and they'll form a vessel right in front of your eyes. And it's a very powerful message, but maybe for some of our kids, they probably have never seen somebody working at a potter's wheel and making something out of clay. He's working at his wheel, and in verse 4 it says that the vessel was spoiled. Some translations put it that the vessel was marred, had an imperfection in it. And sometimes I think we often forget, because of our culture and our current situation, that potters were a very valued trade, because you had vessels for to basically use like spittoons and restrooms, and then you had other vessels that kept the flour and the wine and the precious goods. There was a wide range of values with this pottery. And so it was up to the potter then to decide, when he took that lump of clay, what to make. Am I making a wine vessel out of this? Or is this going to be for keeping food or other uses in the home? It's not the clay that determines its shape or its value, but it is the potter. And something that occurred to me, and that has occurred to me each time I read this passage, is that when we really get down to the nitty-gritty of pottery, you have two basic elements, dirt and water. Dirt and water. You know, what else in the Bible talks about dirt and water? Well, mankind is made from the dust of the earth. He's nothing more than dirt in his intrinsic value. And yet, in the Old Testament and in the New Testament, it talks about the Spirit of God and life coming from water. The streams of eternal life, the pouring out of the Spirit like water. This has, I think, significant value when we look at the potter forming the clay, because he is the one who has to take those two basic elements, the dirt and the water, and to mix them together into something that can be usable for him. Without the water, the clay is useless. It's just to be out in the fields, and even then, it's not good for planting anything in. And yet the water by itself is useful and can sustain life, but water in and of itself can't make a beautiful pottery. It's only when those two things are placed together by the will of the potter that they're made into something special. So as this potter was taking this lump of clay that he had already prepared ahead of time, many potters will have an entire room with clay that they're setting up at different various concentrations of dirt and water. Or they're trying to let a certain section soak in the water and a certain section start to dry out to be able to be used. They place that on the wheel, and then they start adding more water to it as they start shaping it. But the only thing that comes up as they're starting to shape it, as the wheel is spinning. And one of the things I thought of this week is how spoiled we are in our modern times. I was watching a video of a potter in the modern day working a wheel. It was an electric wheel. They could set the speed and how fast it turned, if it was uneven or if it was level. You know, when Jeremiah was looking at this, it was probably a guy either kicking the wheel with his foot or some type of primitive lever to get the wheel spinning. And yet we're so spoiled today, we have all these doodads in order to do it. But here, this potter has taken a very specific lump of clay, something that he has prepared ahead of time to use and to shape. he's working in it, and all of a sudden he notices that as he's shaping it, there's a mar, there's an imperfection, that it had been spoiled. And the potter then has two decisions. He can take that clump of clay and throw it back with the other clumps and say, well, I will deal with it later. Either I'll add some more clay, or I'll add some more water, and I'll work out the imperfections. Or he can let it dry and break it into dust pieces, and then to add water again later, and then to form another lump of clay. But this second process often involves fire. That if they choose at some point in the process that it comes into a certain shape and they want to get the perfections out of it, they need to dry it. They need to put it into the fire to bring out those imperfections. And it just reminds me of the church and what God does, and what Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Then we build upon our foundation, which is Christ, with gold, silver, and precious stone, and it will all be tested. It will be revealed by the fire. So as God works in our life, and as he's molding us as this clump of clay, that those imperfections come out like the fire that refines the gold. No wonder it is that the psalmist said that we need to buy gold that is refined in the fire. And Jesus says, wish as it were that you would come to me, that you would buy this gold refined in the fire. We are the vessels, and he builds upon us with these good works of gold, silver, and precious stones. And yet sometimes he has to take that clump when it gets marred, when it gets imperfect, and goes through the process of either reforming or starting over. And you know what? It's good for the lump of clay that process happens. Or else they're never made to their potential. I have a martial arts friend who's an artist, something that I cannot do. I'm not an artiste. I can barely draw stick figures, and even that badly. And yet he can take a picture of someone all dressed up in their martial arts uniform with black belts on and look all mean. And it's almost a lifelike image. I was reading also, some famous sculptors have said, they'll look at a large piece of granite and say, I'm going to remove from the granite that which is not the sculpture. And I'm sitting there going, what? What did you just say? That doesn't compute in my little mind. You remove some of the stone to reveal the sculpture? Isn't it kind of you remove the stone to create the sculpture, not to reveal it? And that really stuck in my mind this week in looking at this potter working on the vessel. As the potter looks at that clump of clay, he's already able in its innate form to know, I'm going to shape it and mold it into what I love. It is going to be revealed in it through the working and the refining and the molding and the shaping, the continually adding of water, of the Spirit to form it into what it needs to be. Verse 5, Jeremiah 18. As Jeremiah is seeing this transformation of the clump of clay, it's marring and then being reworked into a new vessel. The word of the Lord came to Jeremiah, and he's probably like, okay, God, what's the lesson? He's smart enough. He's heard from God enough. Okay, God, I'm here for a reason. What's this reason? Well, what is it that I'm seeing? And in verse 6, O house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter has done? Reminds me so much of Romans chapter 8 and 9. Who are you, O man, to say to God anything? We're the dust of the earth. Our only value comes when the Holy Spirit comes to reside in us, and then God starts to shape us and mold us like this clay. Cannot God then choose to mold, as he says later in Romans chapter 8, vessels for honor and vessels for dishonor? vessels that you could call spittoons or ornate wine goblets or vases? Yes. And that's in fact what he's telling Jeremiah. That the nation needs to understand that it is God and God alone that shapes it and molds it into what he wills. Does the clay have any say on what it will become? No. It is the potter who shapes it. It's the potter who sees its value and puts value into it. Verse 7, if at any time I declare concerning a nation or a kingdom. Notice the structure there. It's the Lord saying about a nation or kingdom, not the other way around. It is the Lord in his plan and his purpose with every nation that has ever happened on the earth, or will. That if I pluck up and break down and to destroy it, which is his prerogative, he is the Lord. And if that nation concerning which I have spoken turns from its evil, I will relent of the disaster that I am intended to do to it. Wait a minute, Chris. You mean to say that as we've been talking about God's will, does not God already know whether or not that nation will repent? Yeah. We don't. That's the great difference between us and God. We experience things in time, years and days and months. But God can see human history as though he sees this pen. He is not controlled by it. He is the one that, in fact, can deal with it as he wishes at any point. So that it is no surprise to God when a nation rejects him and then he brings them down. Oh, kind of reminds me of Israel, right? In sending the prophets, which he knows that they're going to kill. In sending the prophets in which tell Israel to repent and to go back to the Lord. And what happens? They reject them and go into exile. And yet, on the other hand, if I declare concerning a nation or a king that I will plant it and build it, can't help but think of our nation. And his planting and building being upon a people that it were at least God-fearing, and some of whom I would say were actually regenerate believing Christians. That God chose to bless that, that he was the one working in the nation to plant it and to build it. But just as the same as God choosing and planting a nation like Israel, and if it does evil in my sight, not listening to my voice, I'll say that last part again, not listening to my voice. There seems to be a theme here in Jeremiah 18, right? The voice of the Lord came to Jeremiah. Jeremiah, go down to the potter's house. You will hear my voice. If they do evil in my sight, not listening to my voice. We have Jeremiah listening, and now this nation that is not. And then I will relent of the good that I had intended to do to it. We see Israel going through this wave of God raising up a good king that removes the idols, and they go back to worshiping the Lord, and the Lord blesses them. And then at another time, a wicked king arises in his place, in which they go back to worshiping the Asherahs and the Astartes and all the other quote-unquote gods. And God either sends them into exile or into captivity. Or for many years, not being a nation at all. Is it not then all a part of God's plan? That no matter what's happening in the United States right now with the supposed mini nations that are popping up in cities, with people who literally want to see the world burn, with people who want to incite violence and to bring chaos to our nation, how can we say that is not a part of God's plan? Is it the wickedness of men that God holds them responsible? Yep. Does God choose then to use that in the course of a nation? You betcha. It's not for us to figure out how the hows and the whys. It's for us to say, God, let your will. As we looked at last week, who are we to say that we're going to do this or that or go go into a town and spend there a year in James chapter 4. No, it's better for us to say, if the Lord wills, we will do this or that. So then, when taking that personal responsibility to say that if the Lord wills, then when we look at our nation, we have to say, if the Lord wills, he will bring revival. If the Lord wills, he will draw men unto himself. Is this something that we desire? Oh, yeah. We would love to see America return to God, and yet realize that it might be a part of God's plan to judge a nation such as the United States. This isn't the easiest thing for humanity to accept. The plans, the purposes, and the will of God in the matter of time. And yet we know from Ephesians chapter 1 verse 11 that all things are by his plan and his purpose. All things. Nothing escapes his plan or purpose. So then we have to go back and say, if the Lord wills. To where we get to the point where we're like Job and say, the Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. That takes spiritual maturity. That takes spiritual gumption in order to be humble enough to say, if the Lord wills. And not to have it be a cliche, not, you know, God willing and the creek don't rise. But honestly saying, I don't know what tomorrow is going to bring, but I know God does. And being willing then to say, if the Lord wills. Knowing that whatever comes, God already knows is going to come. It is part of his plan and his purpose. This is one of the areas in which Christians in their maturity need to come to. That's kind of a jumping off point for them in realizing of God's plans and purposes and then submitting their will to his. In realizing, well, God really does have all things in his hand. The very fact that when we look at John chapter 6 and John chapter 10, that if we are in the Father's hand, and Jesus says first that we are in Jesus' hand, then he goes on to say in John 6, 44, that you are in the Father's hand, and no one can pluck you out. What safer place is there to be but in the Father's hand? That no matter what happens around the hand and in space and time, that we can continue to say that we are safe in his hand, and if the Lord wills, we will do this or that. Let's pray. Lord, now as we head from here out to the highways and the byways of life, Lord, may you work in us. May your Spirit work in our hearts to recognize your will, your plan. May we constantly ask, Lord, what is your will? May we ask, Lord, teach us to ask what your will is. Teach us to seek your will. Teach us to look to you no matter the situation, no matter the potential outcomes, that we would be like Job and say, the Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. That we would be like Jeremiah and listening to your word and then applying it to our lives. Lord, that it takes a work that only you can do in our lives to bring us to that point, that we look and become more and more like Christ, who said, I do nothing but the will of my Father. I am only working where my Father is working. That even while here on earth, he submitted himself to the will of the Father. Lord, might we learn from that, to grasp that, to hold on to that, and then to live lives in such a way that brings glory and honor to you. Lord, I pray that you would bless us, that you would keep us, and make your face shine upon us and give us rest this week. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. See you guys later out in the parking lot. See everybody else later. Have a blessed week. And make sure you guys say hi before.